Good morning, church. This is the day that the Lord has made. We rejoice and be glad in it. I want to welcome each and every one of you from wherever you are, if you're watching on YouTube, if you're live on Zoom or Facebook. You are all welcome, for the word of God says, the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness. That is in the book of Psalms 24. The world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. This is wherever you are. It's a confirmation of wherever you are. Know that God is there with you. And be ready. Get ready to listen to the word of God. Be ready to praise. Be ready to worship. For he dwells in the praises of his people. The word of God says that the entrance of his word gives light. And because you're going to listen to the word of God, it is going to give you light wherever you are. So brethren, feel welcome. Feel at the feet of Jesus Christ. And open up your heart, open up your spirit, that God will have a place in you, that the word that is going to speak, it will have life and it will be light unto you. And with those remarks, let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, the Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts. We are so grateful, God, that you've given us yet another day to praise you, to worship you, to speak to you, O God. We are so happy, mighty Father, that you have given us the breath of life. Wherever we are in this world, as you have told us in your word, that the world is yours and the fullness thereof. Wherever we are in this world, O God, it belongs to you. How I pray, mighty Father, that where my brethren are, that they will feel that you are in their midst, you are in the presence, you are doing a great and mighty thing in their lives. How I pray, mighty Father, that they will be expectant, that this morning, oh God, they will hear from you, that this morning the word that will be spoken will heal their hearts, the songs and the praises will heal us in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray, mighty God, that you'll have a place in our heart, oh God. We are so expectant of you, mighty Father. Jehovah God, how I pray that you bring to life the things that have died in the name of Jesus. Father, we are calling those things that are dead to come back to life in the name of Jesus Christ. The ministries that have died to come back to life in the name of Jesus. The prophecies that God, you've spoken to us, to come alive in the name of Jesus Christ, as you did with Ezekiel. Father, he said that it is only you who can bring those bones together. And Father, you breathed on them and they joined together and they started life again. How I pray, mighty God, that we'll start life again in the name of Jesus Christ. Wherever we are in our houses, wherever we are, wherever we are listening, how I pray, mighty God, that your spirit will go through in each and every person this morning. My God and my Father, I thank you because there is nothing that you do not know. Thank you, mighty Father, because your word, the entrance of your word is going to bring light in the name of Jesus Christ. Those people who are in darkness, they are going to see the light of God in the name of Jesus. For you are the light of the world. Father, this morning, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for each and every person listening. We thank you, mighty Father, for the speaker of the word. We thank you, mighty God, even for those in the technology. We pray that God Almighty, everything is going to work in place for your own glory in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord God Almighty, we are so grateful. We want to thank you. For the word of God says that we cannot but speak the things we have heard. Mighty Father, we have heard your word. And that's what the disciples said in the book of Acts 4:20. We cannot but speak the things we have heard and seen. And the things that we have heard and seen is that God, you are the healer. God, you are the one who gives revelation. You are the one who builds. You are the one who delivers. And those are the things that you are going to speak in the name of Jesus Christ. As the disciples stood and said that they cannot speak anything else, we are going to speak your word in this end time in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that you give us more strength, give us more spirit, increase us, mighty Father, even as the disciples ask you. We are here asking you, mighty Father, renew our strength, rekindle the fire in us, O God, that we may have the love of God in us in the name of Jesus, that our youth will see how to see them, that they need God in their lives in the name of Jesus Christ. The young children will see that they need God in their lives in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for you are God who hears. Your ears are attentive to hear the cry of your children. We pray for the whole world, oh God, and we pray that this world, because it's yours, we command it to hear your voice in the name of Jesus Christ. And we pray that each and every minister, wherever they are, oh God, how I pray that you anoint them once again, that anointing that draws men and women to yourself, how I pray that you pour it once again in them in the name of Jesus Christ. God Almighty, you are good, you are great, you are awesome, oh mighty Father, you are awesome. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they praised you. They praised you even in those hard times. And even us in these hard times, we are confessing that we are going to praise you in the name of Jesus Christ. Have your way, oh Lord. Have your way. Your word says that miracles and wonders follow them that believe. We believe in your word, oh God. We believe in you, dear Father. We believe in you, Holy Spirit of God. Take over, oh Lord, as the word will be going forth, oh mighty Father. You don't lay a table, mighty Father, without people to come and eat it. Jehovah God, I pray that those hungry will come and eat it. We are knocking at those doors, oh God. We are knocking at those hotels, oh mighty Father, that they listen to the word of God in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray, as your word says, that you're the one who is going to soften those hard hearts, and you're going to give them the heart of flesh. I pray that you give them the heart of flesh, oh God. Father, have your way. Have your way, O Lord. Have your way, mighty Father, that Jehovah God will know that in this time we are living in, Lord God, we will praise you. We will praise you, Almighty Father. We are going to maximize everything that you are doing unto us, O Lord. Father, we praise you. We praise you, O God. We speak healing upon the sick. We speak deliverance upon those who need deliverance. We speak, mighty Father, peace like a river, those who need peace in the name of Jesus. We are speaking peace in every house. We are speaking healing in every hospital, in every home. We are speaking healing in the name of Jesus Christ. We are speaking healing in every nation of the world, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, you have told us that fear not. You are continuing to tell us that we fear not, and we are not going to fear. We are not going to fear, because everything belongs to you. The earth is yours, O Lord, and there is nothing that happens without you knowing. Lord, I pray that you increase us once again. Give us more wisdom, mighty Father. Give us more discernment, O Lord. Give us more willingness to read your word, to understand your word through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit of God, you are our teacher. You are our guide. Take over and take control. We thank you, Father. We give you praise. Mighty God, even as we enter to praise and worship, how I pray that we are going to praise you. We are going to praise you, for you are looking them, who will praise you in truth and in spirit. How I pray we are going to praise you in truth and in spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. Have your way, Jehovah God. Have your way, mighty Father. Remember our leaders, oh God. Remember, mighty Father, our spiritual leader. We bring Bishop Lucas to you, oh God, and his family. We pray that you continue, mighty Father, to work in his life. Continue to give him more wisdom in doing the work of God. Continue to open more doors for him in the name of Jesus Christ. Continue, mighty Father, to work in his life in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord God, have your way. And the other ministers, oh God, remember them, Jehovah God, and mighty Father, fill them with your word, oh God, that you are going to fill them, refresh them every day, every morning, every evening, in the name of Jesus Christ. We will praise you, Jehovah God, from the raising of the sun to the going down of the same. The name of the Lord will be praised, and we are going to praise you, oh God, for you are great and greatly to be praised. Have your way, mighty Father. Be exalted, O Lord. Be lifted high, O mighty Father. Have your way, O Jehovah God. In whatever we do, may you receive all the glory, O mighty God. We love you, Lord, and we thank you once again for what you're doing in our lives. Thank you, Jehovah God, for being with us in this day, O Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. We are rejoicing and we are glad in it. Move like never before, O Lord. Move like never before. We pray this believing in the name of Jesus Christ, and the whole church said, amen and amen. Welcome once again. Be ready to praise and worship. Get ready to praise the Lord. Put on your dancing shoes and let us praise in Jesus' mighty name.
Precious Holy Spirit, rebel o'er fresh on us, fill us up, O God, to an overflow, consume it, fire, burn within us now, ignite us. Till it overflow, precious Holy Spirit, blow afresh on us, fill us up, O God, to an overflow, consuming fire. Precious. overflows. We fast for you. Let it rain on earth. Let it rain. Pour it out, Lord. Till it overflows. We fast for you, Lord. Let it rain on earth. Pour it out on earth. Till it overflows. We fast for you. With us for you. With us for you. Pour it out on earth till it overflows. We fast for you, Lord. I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. You won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming. strong tower, Jesus. To you belong all power, Jesus. Whenever I call your name, you always come and make a way. Your name is a strong tower, Jesus. Ooh, yeah. Your name is a strong tower, Jesus. To you belong all power, Jesus. Whenever I call your name, you make a way. Your name is a strong tower, Jesus.
Your name is a strong tower, Jesus.
To you belong.
To you belong all power,
Jesus. Hey, whenever I call your name,
you make a way.
Ooh, your name is a strong tower, Jesus. When we pray in the name of Jesus, every knee must bow. When we pray in the name of Jesus, every knee must bow. When we pray in the name of Jesus, every knee must bow. When we pray in the name of Jesus, every knee must bow. Hey, your name is a strong tower,
Jesus.
To you belong.
To you belong.
To you belong.
Jesus.
Okay. Hello. Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to worship with all of you again. I was wondering if you all can hear me. If you can, just put a yes on the chat, okay? Because sometimes my computer might not be the best. Once again, if keeping with... all right. Thank you. Thank you for confirming that you can hear me. It's certainly good to worship God on a Sunday, and to remember him in our lives. Now, although there are not many of us, I think that the Bible says, whenever two or three are gathered, the Lord Jesus will be among us. So he can be the silent one in the watching us from Zoom. Anyway, today I would like to share with regards to the topic, or in keeping with the topic, God's abundant mercies or divine maximization. Before that, let us pray. Father, Lord God Almighty, we want to thank you for the opportunity we can come before you to praise you, to worship you, and to sing praises to your name. Lord, we thank you for loving each and every one of us, for knowing the fears, the anxieties, the difficulties that we endure, for being with us, for being so faithful and kind to us, never giving us up. We pray that as we listen to your word, we pray you may speak to us, that you may teach us, we may learn from your word, we may apply it into our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. Now, have you all ever thought back, if you look back, early this morning, I was with my wife. We went for our early morning groceries at Morrison's, one of the big supermarkets. We tend to go very early so that we will miss the Sunday crowd. And usually on Sunday, they will put the best type of groceries, the freshest vegetables, the freshest fish, and everything will be nicely stocked. So when you go early in the morning, you get the first bit. And I was leaving, there was this homeless man. He was selling the magazine Big Issue, you see. And as I passed him, I thought to myself, he's probably in his mid-50s. Looks a bit disheveled and a bit lost. But, I could see a smile on his face. And I decided to buy a Big Issue. It's only £1 from him. And he was very grateful, you see. And I was walking back. I overheard a conversation from another customer that passing by. And this customer said, this man, must have made several bad decisions in his life, that he has become, a homeless person, having to sell the Big Issue magazine in front of a supermarket. So I wondered to myself, bad decisions in life. Could it be that he is where he is because of the decisions that he made when he was younger? Now, if each and every one of us, if we are honest, if we look back into our lives, you will notice that there are some decisions that we could have chosen otherwise. There are some things that we have done that we regret doing. And like everything, whatever we do will have consequences, you see. But then I thought to myself, what is the difference between me and that man, that homeless man who was selling Big Issue? Am I better than him? am I luckier than him? Am I more blessed? Is it because I'm not homeless that God has chosen his favor on me? Or because I've made better decisions than him? So I thought to myself, you know, and throughout the rest of the morning, I was thinking about that. So after the grocery shopping, I came back and I prayed to God and said, you know, what do you want me to learn from here? And I would like to share with you from the Bible, from Luke. If you have your Bibles, can you turn to Luke chapter 7, verse 36 to 50? Luke chapter 7, verse 36 to 50. This is Jesus being anointed by a sinful woman. Reading from verse 36. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. Verse 37. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. Verse 39. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Verse 40. Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. Verse 41. Two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them could pay him back, so he forgave the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned towards the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears, and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests begin to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sin?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Go in peace." See, when I read this, this morning, after meeting up with that homeless guy, I was so encouraged, and suddenly I realized that there is no difference between me and that homeless man. His situation might, be due to some decisions he's made, but without the grace of God, all of us are like that sinful woman. Now, if you look at this scripture again, you will see there are three persons here, three different characters. First, you see Simon, the Pharisee. Second, you will see this woman, the sinful woman. Her name is not mentioned. And then you will see the character of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whom these two persons are interacting with. Jesus is the center of this story, but you see the two different reactions people tend to give to him. You see, Jesus was invited by this Pharisee, Simon, to have dinner with him. Now, I'm not sure what Simon's motive is. Is it to test Jesus? Is it to, to ascertain who Jesus is? Is it to rub, his shoulders with Jesus, the celebrity? For me, I think that if you read here, Simon wanted to know Jesus out of curiosity. Not because he adored Jesus, not because he worshipped Jesus, not because he respected Jesus. the way he invited Jesus for dinner was a very, very cordial invitation. It was like a co-invitation. Because you see, Jesus highlighted that when you visit someone in the Middle East during Jesus' time, when you enter a house to have dinner, usually because it's a hot and dusty-like country, the host, when you reach the house, the host will bring out water to wash your feet. See, that water will clean away all the dust or the mud that you have, you know, had during the whole day. So when your legs is clean, you can then recline on the table, you know, or on the cushion to have food. This was their tradition. So to deny Jesus water for his legs and just to, you know, and apart from water for his legs, usually after a dry long day, they will put oil on the guest's head. This oil is meant to refresh, revitalize the person. It's just like if you are feeling tired on a hot, dry day, you wash your face to refresh you. So those oil is a welcoming oil and a welcoming water for your legs. Now, Simon, out of contempt, refused to provide Jesus all this. But you see, Jesus is the Son of God. And if one party refused to provide for the other, the Lord Jesus will still get his glory and honor. But I would like also to draw your attention to this lady, to this sinful woman. Now, how do we see divine maximization in this? Look at this woman. She is what we call a sinful woman. Some commentators say she might well be a prostitute. Have you ever thought to wonder what would drive a woman to be a prostitute? What could have happened in her life that would have traumatized and damaged her so badly that she would end up becoming a prostitute? You see, you know, becoming a whore, becoming someone whom society would have little regards with. Up to today, you know, it's like somebody or an alcoholic or a junkie. These are not very nice words that stigmatizes people unfairly and unjustly. And up to today, they still do it, you see. You know, I was thinking this lady must have had a horrible childhood, probably a horrible adulthood, that her self-esteem must be so low that she has ended up becoming a prostitute to sell herself, you know, to sell her body in order to get money. She might be a victim of sexual abuse, a victim of sexual traffickers. She might have been abused by someone close to her when she was growing up, so much so that her innocence must have been taken from her at such a young age that she is faced, you see, with no other choice than being a prostitute. She could have been raped. She could have been abused. That nobody, you know, no Jewish man would marry her, you see. Imagine what type of life she would have, never knowing about love, never experiencing family, never being able to have her own children. You know, it is a very hard life. And if she's caught, you see, she could be stoned to death according to the Jewish law. After all, who would care for a life of a prostitute? You know, the other thing we can speculate is maybe she made wrong decisions in life. Maybe she married the wrong person. Maybe she married an abusive husband. You know, lots of things could have gone wrong in her life, which she had little power to change, little power to help herself. But I respect this lady. You know, when I read through this verse, scripture, I respect her because this lady, although she lives on the fringes of society, although nobody would pay her attention, you know, she would have no voice at all. After all, she is a sinful woman, someone which people would spit at would look down. Even, you know, Simon, the Pharisee, the moment she entered Simon's house, straight away, you know, he noticed that this is a sinful woman. You know, he did not want to do anything because he wanted to see Jesus' reaction, whether Jesus would slap her, kick her out of the house, whether Jesus would treat her unjust, I mean, badly or not. He wanted to see, you see, because Simon, being a Pharisee, is a very proud man. And you can see her, the way, why I say he's proud, is the way he treated Jesus, you know, with contempt. That although he invited Jesus into his house for dinner, he didn't provide water, he didn't provide oil, you know, the way he must have looked down at the Lord Jesus. But you see, Jesus, being holy, you know, being loving, did not raise it against Simon initially. He did not demand his rights. But Jesus quietly went. And you see, Jesus being God, you know, if I remember when Jesus was coming into Jerusalem, his triumphant entry, that the Pharisees said to his disciples, said to Jesus, shut your disciples, you know. And Jesus said, if my disciples would keep quiet, the rocks will shout out. So God will always receive glory. And if Simon missed that opportunity, Jesus' glory came from this lady. And what do I mean by that? You know, this lady, why I respect her so much, she knew her life was in a mess. She knew that there was nowhere out. She knew that no one would treat her as a person. No one would care for her, except one. And this person goes by the name of Jesus. And I believe that she must have been following Jesus, you know, from a distance because of the stigma she has, a sinful woman, a prostitute, you know, not within his close group. You know, she has been watching Jesus. She must have been listening to what Jesus was saying when he preached to the 5,000 and he preached to the 4,000. You know, she must have been following Jesus' life, Jesus' ministry very closely. So much so that she even knew that Jesus was invited to go to Simon the Pharisee's house for dinner. And she knew that Jesus was the only guest invited, you know, no disciples, nobody, you see. And she took this opportunity. She took this opportunity, you know, she gambled everything she had, you know, by coming into Simon's house to meet the Lord Jesus uninvited. She was taking a big risk, you see. She could be kicked out, beaten, you know, spat at. But she decided the risk is worth taking because she recognized something different in our Lord Jesus, something that is different, that set him out from the teachers of the law than from the rabbis, you see. She would never in her life dare to go up to a Pharisee, a rabbi, you know, that would condemn her, that would, you know, spit at her, that would beat her up, you see. Because for them, you know, she is nothing. You know, she has sinned against God. She deserved to pay her full punishment. But you look at this lady, you know, as we continue to see God's word, in verse 37, a woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. Now, why does St. Luke highlighted this alabaster jar of perfume? Now, an alabaster jar of perfume at that time was the most expensive perfume you can ever get. You know, some commentators say that it's probably worth a year's wages, you know, a year's wages. Now, a year's wages in the UK, average GDP, is about 25,000. That is in Glasgow, in Scotland. In down south England, slightly higher at £28,000. So imagine buying a jar of perfume worth almost £30,000. A year's wages. You know, I'm not sure what type of perfume as expensive as that exists. I'm sure it does, you know, probably for the super rich. And this lady realized, you know, in order to show her love and devotion, she decided to get the most expensive perfume, you know, not just oil, but perfume, you see. and she brought it in with her. And what was she going to do with that perfume? The Bible says, you know, as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. Here you can see through her actions, this lady truly repented. How? Sorry, that's my daughter. Truly repented. How? You see, she spent her money, probably her year's wages, on the most expensive perfume she could get. And because of, she was so ashamed of her sin that she dare not even meet the Lord Jesus, you know, face to face. She came behind him. And she dare not even stand at his head. She stand at his feet. And she began to cry. To cry, to repent, to be remorseful of what she has done in the past. Because of her sins, because of her wickedness, because of a mistake she has made that has caused her to end up like this. Coming before God with a broken heart. The Bible says that a broken heart, a contrived spirit. These are the sacrifices God will never reject. You see? And although Simon did not provide Jesus with any water to wash his legs after a dusty, dirty day, she provided the tears of her eyes. You know, for me, if you ask me what is the most expensive water you can get in this world, I would say the most expensive water you can get are the tears of a repentant person. You see, you know, she started to cry, to repent of her sins, to remember her rebellion before God, to remember what has happened in her life. You see, and as she remembered, as she asked God for forgiveness, she began to cry, the tears from her heart. You know, this is the most expensive type, the most precious type of water you can ever get, you see, from the eyes of a repentant, from the heart of a repentant sinner. And the Bible says she began to wet Jesus' feet, you know. And as she continued crying, her tears cleansed the mud, the dirt from the Lord Jesus' feet. And what happens? The Bible says then, you know, she used her hair to clean, to wipe the tears off Jesus' feet. Brothers and sisters, you know what is the most precious thing a female values on her body? Most females would say, it is my hair. You see, if you on the TV, switch on the TV, if you look on the internet or advertisements, you will see a lot of advertisements about shampoo, about conditioner, you know. Very few for men, but mostly targeted at females, you see, because because for females, their hair is very important, very precious. You know, I can say with some experience, because I have a wife and three daughters, and all of them keep long hair. Sometimes I would teach them saying, you should cut your hair like dads, you know, like daddies, you know, a short hair. And then they will laugh at me saying, I'm going bald. You see, what do I understand about keeping long hair? Now, keeping long hair for most females is very precious. You know, that the hair on their body, they will love to take care of it, keep it clean. And here you see this sinful woman, this woman whom society looks down upon, whom society has decided she's useless, you know, who has very little self-esteem, uses the most precious part of her body, the most beautiful part of her body, which is her hair, to clean Jesus' feet, you know. You see, not some ugly rug, not some ugly cloth, you know, but beautiful, luscious hair to clean Jesus' feet. So you can see that this woman, man business, you know, she realized that only Jesus can save her. Only Jesus can forgive her sin. Only Jesus can give a new life. And she knows that only Jesus loves her, that Jesus will not condemn her or be angry with her. So she took that chance and she gave Jesus all she could. She bought the most expensive alabaster jar of perfume. She wet Jesus' legs with the most precious liquid you can find on earth, which is tears from a contrived heart. She cleansed Jesus' feet with hair, with her own hair, you know, with the most precious and beautiful part of the body. And not only that, she continued doing it when Jesus was eating, you see. And then she kissed Jesus' feet, you know, kissed Jesus' feet. I'm not sure about you, but for me, I think kissing is a very personal thing. I know parents, you know, as a parent, I kiss my girls goodnight. I kiss my wife. You know, kissing here sometimes is regarded as a greeting. But when I read this verse, kissing continuously his feet, crying and wiping away her tears with her hair, tells me that this lady, you know, is showing the ultimate adoration to the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, she is acknowledging that he is her savior, that he has the power to change her life. And I find this amazing. You know, this simple truth was lost to Simon the Pharisee, the teacher of the law, who treated Jesus with so much contempt that even basic, you know, basic customary rituals like greeting a guest, he totally excluded it. But, you know, God is not left shorthanded. Jesus was provided this by this beautiful lady, you know, whom Simon contemptuously called her, you know, a sinful person. Let's continue, you see. Now, verse 39, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man was a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner. And Jesus knew that this woman is a sinner, but he also knew what was going on in her heart of her sincere repentance. And Jesus knew what was going through Simon's mind, you know. That's why in verse 40, Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. You can see the contempt dripping from his mouth. In verse 41, Jesus said, two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back. So he forgave the debts of them both. Now, which one of them would love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgotten. So you can see even from his tone of language, the contempt he had for Jesus, you know. I suppose, you know, I suppose. You see. And that was where Jesus caught him and exposed his self-righteous hypocrisy. You see, Simon could not understand and could not see that he was one of those who owed Jesus money. Or we, all of us like Simon, owe God money in terms of our sin, you know, our debts. We cannot repay this before God, whether it's 500 denarii or 50 or 100 denarii or 150. Each of us owe God different types of debt. But the key is we can't pay it. We can't pay it. This Simon, although he was a teacher of the law, although he was a Pharisee, appears to have forgotten the fact that he too is a sinner and that he owes God and can never repay. So he is no better than that sinful woman who was touching the feet of the Lord Jesus, who was wiping the Lord Jesus' feet with her hair, wetting them with her tears, and anointing his feet with the most expensive perfume that can be bought. You see, this contrasts the reaction of two people who are both sinners, who cannot pay their debts to God. The only difference is one of them, which is the sinful woman, realized this and acknowledges this and repents. Whereas Simon, totally been forgetful, does not even know, had no insight into it. And look at verse 43. Jesus said, "You have judged correctly," he said. Then Jesus told a very important lesson to all of us, not only to Simon or to the lady. I think the lady was hearing all this, you know. Then Jesus turned to the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears." You see, you know, God deserves the best and he will get the best. "Fine, Simon, you didn't give me any water. That's okay. This woman gave me the most precious liquid ever, her tears from a contrite heart," you see, "and wiped them with her hair," you know, with her hair, the most beautiful and important part of a female's body, their hair, you see. In verse 45, "You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet." Amazing, amazing. And for me, I would never kiss another person's feet, especially after a long day, you know. His feet might be dirty, smelly, full of mud, full of dust. But yet this lady, Jesus said, has not stopped kissing my feet. In verse 46, "You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet." You see, look at the contrast. Look at the contrast here. The Lord Jesus was contrasting, you know, two sinners' reaction to him. Two people who cannot pay their debt. You see, it's just that one of them had no insight into the fact that he owes God, that he's a sinner. But the other one, she recognized who she was, you know, and that she needed to be saved. See, that's amazing. You know, I pray that I may not be like Simon, who casually treat Jesus with contempt, who takes advantage of who Jesus is, who use Jesus like a butler, you know, like a prayer request, but do not give Jesus the glory and honor which is due to his name. I pray that God may make us humble, that I may be as humble as this woman who realized our true sinfulness, who realized that we are worthless without Jesus, that before God, we are nothing, and who recognized who Jesus is, her savior, her salvation, her key to a new life, her key to regeneration. And she held on to Jesus. She came in, rather than saying, "I'm sorry," rather than using any words, her non-verbal action speaks so much more. You see, you know, action speaks louder than truth, brothers and sisters. And here we see a perfect example of devotional action from a lady, from a person whose heart is broken, a contrite heart, a repentant heart. You see, not only that, the Lord Jesus said in verse 46, "You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet," expensive perfume too. "Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as she has shown great love. But whoever has forgiven little, loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Notice throughout this whole paragraph, right, there was no interaction, no verbal interaction or communication from the lady to the Lord Jesus. Maybe because the lady felt that she was unworthy to speak to the Lord Jesus, that, you know, she, for me, right, when she was, my imagination anyway, you know, I must think that she even turned her eyes away from meeting the eyes of the Lord Jesus because of who he is. You know, she recognized that this is the Son of God, the Messiah who can save her from her sin, who can give her life. Therefore, she came in total humility, total weakness, you know, not even daring to speak, you see. And you see, in the end, who got the blessing? Did Simon, who invited Jesus into the house, get the blessing? No, it was this lady. And what was the blessing she had? The blessing she had from the Lord Jesus is this: your sins are forgiven. And Jesus said to the woman again, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. What Jesus has done at that moment, not only supernaturally cleansed her of her sins, but gave her a new life, gave her a new beginning, gave her a new start. You see? It's like saying to her, daughter, I have heard your cry of repentance. Daughter, I have seen that you are genuine, that you love much, and that you love me. You have not withheld giving me the best. You know, you gave me the most expensive perfume to anoint my legs. Although you didn't have water, your tears has cleansed my leg. And you use your hair, the most beautiful part of your body, to clean my dirty legs. And on top of that, you never stop kissing me, kissing my legs. You see? And Jesus did not disappoint. He extended his love. He extended his mercy. He extended his grace to this lady. You know, that when the dinner finished, I think that this lady who was the uninvited guest left with a new life, left with a new beginning, left with Jesus as a savior. Whereas Simon the Pharisee learned nothing from it, and in the end, probably lost his soul to the devil because of those unpaid debts. Although God was also willing to forgive Simon, if only he had the insight, if only he had the insight to repent and to accept that mercy. So, brothers and sisters, when we come before God, we are once again, we are once again reminded that although we might be, you know, better than this homeless guy whom I saw outside Morrison supermarket, you know, in the end, he and I are the same. You might have a little bit more money. You might have a little bit more status in society. But to the Lord Jesus, you still owe him money. You are still debtors. And the debt of sin, the debt of due to our sin, we can never by our own works, make it right with God. Like the Lord Jesus said, one owe him 500 denarii, the other 150. Both cannot pay. So it doesn't matter how much you owe, you cannot pay. That's the key. You need the mercy and forgiveness of God. Coming back to this, so where does divine maximization come in? Divine maximization comes in, brothers and sisters, is this: you get a new life in Jesus. You get to, not only when we repent of our sin, not only when we come before God, you know, with a broken and contrived heart, our sins are forgiven, but at the same time, God restores us. The mistakes we have made, the wrong decisions we have made, are put aside. We are given a new start, you see, just like this lady. The Lord Jesus said, not only are your sins forgiven, go in peace. I am giving you a new start. I am giving a new life. And for me, this is amazing. You know, no one else can do that. Society will be less forgiving, just as they were unforgiving to this woman. But the Lord Jesus, we praise God, through his love, is always forgiving, always graceful, always merciful. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time we can come before you. We thank you for the opportunity to read and study a little of Luke, where we see the interaction between the Lord Jesus and also Simon the Pharisee and also the sinful woman. Lord, most of us are like that sinful woman. And we pray that whenever we come before you, we may acknowledge our sins, that we may never treat you with contempt like the way Simon did. But instead, O Lord, to remember what you have done for us, to come in repentance before you, and may you cleanse us of our sin. May you forgive our sins, our rebellion, our rebelliousness. And also, Father, for the mistakes we have made, the decisions that have gone wrong, we commit it into your hands, Father. Thank you for giving us a new beginning, a new life. May you continue to be with us and bless us. And although we have sinned against you in the past, we know that this is forgiven, that you have given us a new clean slate. We pray you may bless and protect each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters. I pass this time back to Kepha.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aaron, for such a powerful message. We pray for special blessings and grace in your life. We pray that the Lord will continue to strengthen you and to protect you and to equip you in everything that you do. May the Lord continue to shower you with his goodness and his mercy and his love. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you.
Yes. Over to you, Sister Karen, to finish the service for us, please.
Thank you so much, Dr. Alan Sam. We really appreciate the word that the Lord has given unto us. I pray that as we began, as the word says, that the entrance of the word gives light, to gives understanding unto the sinful. That is the word of God. As it enters into us, may it change us, and may we see what the Lord wants us to see, and also may we treat Jesus the way that we know that it's the best to do it. And also that we may be able to be in that divine maximization to get a new life and also to have a new beginning in everything. Thank you so much. And at this time, I want to about the meetings. We normally have ladies' prayers every Monday from 6 to 7, and I'm inviting all the ladies to engage in it and also to continue to pray for the nation and also to pray for the Church of Jesus Christ. Also on Wednesdays, we have the Bible study. Let us all be ready to be taught the word, because that is the only place we can be able to learn the word and to ask questions that we may be needing to ask. And also Fridays, we have prayers that is from 6 to 7 as well. And also we engage. Let us all try to engage in everything that GICC has opened for us. And it is a continuation of everything. Also, about the tithes and offerings, you do the tithing in your local church or where the Lord is directing you to do the tithing, and also the offering. The announcement is there. So that is the account for the tithes and offerings. You can put them there and everything is there. The weekly meetings, I've just announced them. So those are the weekly meetings. And with that, I want to thank God for all those that have joined. And let us begin this week with that gear of knowing that once we just fall into the feet of Jesus Christ, he's ready. He's ready to get us and to give us new start. Amen. And with those remarks, I want us to finish with a word of prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, we want to thank you for what you have done. Thank you for the word that you have just spoken unto us, O Lord. How I pray that we are going to walk through and to know that once we fall onto your feet, mighty God, we will be able to be cleansed and to have a new beginning, that we will be able to look unto you, the author and the finisher of our faith. Thank you because of Alan Sam. We pray that you refill him once again, that God, he'll have more to continue to give to your children in the name of Jesus. We surrender the week to you, oh dear God, and we pray that you help us, mighty Father, to walk with discernment, to walk with vigor, looking unto you, and to know that you being with us the whole week, mighty Father, we will be able to conquer it. We thank you and we honor you. We love you, Jesus, because there is nothing without you. We are useless, but with you, we have everything. Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for what you're just about to do. And thank you for what you're continuing to do. We give you glory, praise, and honor. And now let's say the grace of our Lord Jesus.
And the love of God and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. He anoints my head with oil.
My cup runs over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
No weapon formed against us shall prosper, and every tongue which rises against us in judgment will condemn. For this is our heritage as the children of God, and our righteousness
is of God,
Lord, our God.
Amen.
Amen and amen. God bless you and have a great week ahead of you.
Amen.
God bless. Thank you.
God bless you all. Thank you, Sister Karen. Thank you, Dr. Aaron, for such a lovely service. May the Lord continue to renew you and strengthen you. And Brother Keva, for pulling everything together. God bless you so much.
Thank you, Pastor. God bless all of you. Bye-bye.
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 No one nowhere compared to your love. You are holy. We can't live without your love. For you